Nothing was left of Hector's raid except loose smoke swaths drifting over the Aegean like dark hair, and the ditch stained perfect crimson where some outraged god 5 miles tall had stamped on glass. Movement in the air, gulls lift, sideslip, land again, no more. Mindless of everything Achilles said, Patroclus went for Troy. Try to imagine how it looked. In your right hand, a paper fan, 3/4 open. Outward, along the leading edges of the 2 primary blades, the Trojans run towards the rim. The blade that follows off your thumb points towards Troy. The other blade, splayed horizontally across your palm, marks the ditch where the rump was butchered. And Patroclus aims his forces at the point where all the blades are pinned by a tiny swivel. It was here that Thestor, Enop's only son, met the circumstance in his own nature gods call fate, and on this day men called Patroclus. Fate's sister, Fortune, favors those who keep their nerve. Alas, Thestor was not like this. He lost his head first, then his life. His chariot bucked too slow over the rutted corpses, and as Patroclus drew abreast of him, the terrified boy let his horses balk. Better to fight until the end, Thestor. Who knows, you might have nicked him, but with the reins flowing out of his hands, he cowered inside the varnished cradle, weeping. They passed so close that hub skinned hub. Ahead, Patroclus braked a shade. And then, and gracefully as patient men cast fake insects over trout, he speared the boy. And with his hip as pivot, prized Thestor out of the chariot's basket as easily as lesser men detach a sardine from an opened can. 9 more Lycians died on the long run for Troy, and they were no great trouble. If a spear slipped, Patroclus watched their white heels flutter up the plain through dust, while he wiped its half, waited, and picked his next. The day seemed over. Dust could be left to settle. But when their prince, Sarpedon, smelled the Lycians' panic, he wedged his chariot across the rout, pushed up his mask, and laughed. Well run, comrades, but what from? Selecting 2 light javelins. Who will wait to see a known prince fix once and for all this big anonymous Greek? And vaulted off his chariot plate. That makes you sweat! And flexed himself, running his thumb across the points, and scuffed dirt towards Patroclus, who climbed down more slowly, grinning under his iron. It was noon. God and his wife, who is his sister too, watched them prepare. He with regret, she with a certain womanly satisfaction, heard him out. Surely fate has marked enough good men without Sarpedon. Shall I lift him up and away to the clear meadows he rules in Lycia, or shall I let Patroclus have him? And she, I'm sure I don't know why you're asking me. You'll do what suits you best, as usual. But remember this. Others besides yourself have loved ones due today. If one God saves his child, all of them will be doing it, and then where will we be? My dear, I know you love Sarpedon, and I know his death goes hard. Why not do this? Let him fight bravely for a while, and when Patroclus severs him from care and human misery, sleep and death shall carry him to Lycia by Taurus, remembered by wise men throughout the world and buried royally. Noon, striped mosquitoes, nothing stirring. Under the white sun, back and forth across a disk of yellow earth, midway between the ditch and the closed stone capital, the heroes fought like pharaohs, bare-necked hens, wrangling over carrion in midair. They sight each other, stand on their tails, stoop, lock claws, lie back inside their wings, and hang high in between the white-faced pyramids, savaging each other's craws. Likewise, the human champions, until Patroclus' spear nosed past Sarpedon's busy heart, and the ground sense in his body seeped away. He fell as a tree falls, oak, say, or pine, slowly at first, and then with the bright commercial axes thocking at its heart, the tall, hurt trunk lies down and settles resentfully among its leaves. Sarpedon kneeled at first, then lay full length, teeth clenched, and calling, "Glaucus!" behind them. "Glaucus, be quick, or they will strip me even before I'm dead. And if they do it, Glaucus, if my captured weapons prove their jubilee, shame on you, Glaucus, till your dying day. So get our best, all of them. Hector, too, you'll not miss him. And cover me with moving blades till sunset. Then," he was going, "for my sake, going, kill!" And he was gone, sun reflected in his dry green eyes. Patroclus, in his chariot again, wiping his neck, his smiling beard, about to signal the advance. "Listen, master!" Glaucus prayed to Apollo. "Wherever you may be, and you are everywhere, and everywhere you hear men in their trouble, trouble has come to me. Our best is dead, and I am wounded, Lord. Lord, hear my prayer. You know me, and you know I shall fight until I die, but I can barely lift my arm. Lord, put my pain to sleep, and grant me strength enough to keep swords flickering across Sarpedon's ruined body until you lead the sun away." And Apollo, mouse god, lord of the morning, he whose face is brighter than a thousand suns, mollified his wound with precious ointment and let delight like flame rise through his loins. And more, for as Glaucus ran for Hector, Aeneas, the rest, Apollo called, "Son, stand thou still over Ilium, and guard Sarpedon's ruined body till their blades move over it like grasses over stone. Ere into azure steel, the daytime like translucent bronze, and through it all one sun's cord falling, opening out a radiant cone around Sarpedon's body, and him inside it, like a waxen god asleep on his outstretched hand. And his blood broke into hyacinths, and the sand congealed as moss. While Glaucus asked, 'Do you forget your friends so quickly, Hector? They bleed. You sun your knees. While you are safe, they die, are stripped, yes, mutilated too. And the upshot of your caution is the humiliation of our dead. And oh, how easily Ares, the pig-brained butcher god, prods his bronze Greek instruments to put more of us down. Sarpedon's dead, my Hector. Achilles' boyfriend killed him. And you do nothing? Yet not so very long ago you came to him for help, and all you brought was, we would be obliged, and thank you, when he promised it, and kept his promise with half Lycia. And on the day he came before your father could finish multiplying thanks by previous thanks, Sarpedon had put out his weapons, gotten his troops together, and engaged your enemies. That day and every long successive fighting day, he was first out, last home, with laughter, golden words, good words, always the first. First across Agamemnon's ditch today, and now he's dead and has no fellow. How do you fill your obligations, Hector? Mope, worry, count heads? But they had gone, rolling across the plain together like an arrowhead from a kneeling bow shot. Hector leaning over the horses, as if the chariot was fastened to his belly, as if his eyes, not horses, drew the Trojans in towards the boiling spiral. Dust like red mist, pain like chalk on slate, heat like arctic, the light withdrawn from Sarpedon's body, the enemies swirling over it, bronze flak, man against man, banner behind slatted banner, the torn gold overwhelming the faded blue, blue overwhelming gold, both up again, both frayed by arrows that drift like bees, thicker than autumn rain. The left horse falls, the right prances on blades, tearing its belly like a silk balloon, and the shields inch forward under the bowshots, and under the shields the half-lost soldiers think, we fight when the sun rises. When it sets, we count the dead. What has the beauty of Helen to do with us? Half lost with the ochre mist swirling around their knees, they shuffle forward, lost, until the shields clash. Aye! Lines of black ovals, 8 feet high, clash, aye! And in the half-light, who will be first to hesitate, or wavering draw back? And yes, the slow wavering begins, and yes, they bend away from us. As the spears flicker between the black hides, the bronze glows vaguely, and bones show like pink drumsticks. And over it all, as flies shift up and down a hemorrhage alive with ants, the captains in huge iron masks drift past each other, calling, calling, gathering light on their breastplates. So stained they think that they are colleagues, and do not turn, do not salute, or else salute their enemies. But we who are under the shields know our enemy marches at the head of the column, and yet we march. The voice whose orders we obey is the voice of the enemy, yet we obey. And he who is forever talking about enemies is himself the enemy. Light circling over the dunes, the flying white, and far above the soldiers, the larks soar, treading the cloud, breathing the haze. Where is Sarpedon's body? Nobody knows. But Glaucus found a man called Bathycles. He was the richest Greek to sail for Troy. Skins and leathers, a small sword factory, numerous farms, and thought how very proper it would be if Glaucus' death became a part of his estate. So to oblige him, Glaucus ran, and Bathycles, poor fool, ran after him. And Glaucus jumped a broken chariot shaft, and Bathycles jumped, and like a woman wets and puts the cotton through a needle's eye, Glaucus spun on his pads and let his javelin through Bathycles. If Hector waved, his wounded and his sick got up to fight again, and if Patroclus called, the Myrmidons laughed and called back. With them, as with Patroclus, to die in battle was like going home. Inside the yellow spiral, the enemies jammed cheek to cheek, and both, because they could do nothing else, looked up and thought they saw the moon, was it so long, and wondered to themselves, who will be left to praise us if we win? And if we lose, who will there be to bury us? Yet it was not the moon they saw, but the sun turning a day longer than autumn above the dust. You must recall the pause, thock, pause, sounds that are made when axe blades follow each other through a valuable wood. Though the work is going on the far side of the valley, and the axe blows are muted by a mile of clear, still-standing air, they throb gently in your ears. And occasionally you can hear a phrase spoken between the men who are more than a mile away with perfect clarity. Likewise, the sounds of spear against spear, shield against shield, shield against gleaming spear around Sarpedon's body. And nobody, including those who saw him lie like a waxen god asleep on his outstretched hand, could know him now. But if you can imagine how, each evening when the dairy pails come in, innumerable flies throng around the white rough of the milk, you will have some idea of how the Greeks and Trojans clouded about Sarpedon's body. And all this time, God watched his favorite enemies, considering minute Patroclus, a fleck of spinning radium on his right hand. Should he die now, or push the Trojans back still more? And on his left, Prince Hector, like a golden moat. Should he become a coward for an hour and run for Troy while Patroclus steals Sarpedon's gear that glistens like the sea at early morning? The left goes down. In the half-light, Hector's blood turned milky, and he ran for Troy. It is true that men are clever, but the least of gods is cleverer than their best. And it was here, before God's hands, moons poised either side of the world's agate, you overreach yourself, Patroclus. Yes, my darling, not only God was out that day, but Lord Apollo. You know he loves the Trojans, so no matter how much, how often, or how easily you win, once you have forced them back, you stop. Remember it, Patroclus? Or was it years ago Achilles cautioned you outside his tent? Remembering or not, you stripped Sarpedon's gear, ordered your borrowed Myrmidons to drag him off, and went for Troy alone. And God turned to Apollo, saying, Mouse God, take my Sarpedon out of range and clarify his wounds with mountain water. Moisten his body with tinctures of white myrrh and the sleeping iodine. And when the chrisms dry, fold him in minivers that never wear and lints that never fade. And call my two blind footmen, Sleep and Death, and let them carry him to Lycia by Taurus, where his tribe, playing stone chimes and tambourines, will consecrate his royal death as fits a man, before whose memory even the stones shall fade. And Apollo took Sarpedon out of range and clarified his wounds with mountain water, moistened his body with tinctures of white myrrh and the sleeping iodine. And when the chrisms dried, the mouse god folded him in minivers that never wear and lint that never fades, and fetched the two blind footmen, Sleep and Death, and saw they carried him as fits a man, before whose memory even the stones shall fade, to Lycia by Taurus. While this was done, Achilles' overreaching vicar killed Echolus, of whom nothing is known, Paramus, the son of Megas, Sister, an Egyptian horse-dealer, Keth and San, slaves to the former, Crates, a silversmith from Syme, Doran, a regular, Pilate, a cook, Phanes, Gaian, and Master, farriers, Taurus, a merchant-slaver. 3 times Patroclus climbed Troy's wall, 3 times his fingers scraped the parapet, 3 times, and every time he tried it, the smiling mouse god flicked him back. But when he came a 4th, last time, the smile was gone. Instead, from parapet to plain, to beachhead, on across the rocked sunlit Aegean, the mouse god's voice, loud as 10,000 crying together, cried, Greek! Get back where you belong! So loud even the yellow judges, passing sentence half of the world away, paused. Get back where you belong! Troy will fall in God's good time, but not to you! Banner behind slatted banner, blue overwhelming gold, gold over blue, it was Patroclus' turn to run, wide-armed, staring into the fight, and desperate to hide, to blind that voice, to hide behind the moving blades. And as he ran, Apollo, dressed as Priam's brother, settled beside the inner gates and strolled with Hector for a while, and took his arm, and mentioning the ways of duty, love, good conduct, and the other perishable joys infecting men, dissolved his cowardice with promises. Think of it! They stand, like brothers, man and god, chatting together on the parapet that spans the inner gate. The elder points, the other nods, and the plumes nod over them both. Patroclus, cannot see the uncle's finger leading Hector's eye towards his heart. Nor does he hear Apollo whispering, "Achilles' heart will break." And neither man imagines that a god discusses mortals with a mortal. So Hector mounts. Half of each pair of gates swings in, and with the sun across his shoulders like a metal stole, Hector comes out. The light weakens. Up on the hillside, women waist deep in dusk sing while working. The first movement of sunset turns the blue air darker blue. Patroclus fought like dreaming, his head thrown up, his mouth wide as a shrieking mask, sucked at the air to nourish his infuriated body. And the Trojans seem to be drawn to him, locked round his waist, red water washed against his chest, and laid their tired necks beside his sword like birds. Is it a god, divine, needing no tenderness? Yet instantly they touch, he butts them, cuts them back. You know from books and moving pictures how people without firearms set about killing a tiger that had grown too old to prey on antelope or zebra and must confine its diet to the slower animals like man. Following its spoor, they rig a long funnel of netting up on spikes, like pointed clothes props. And the lean, striped beast is driven down its throat by gongs. The net is shut, and when the beast is tired out, the humans kill it in their own good time. But if the net breaks, many humans die. Likewise, Patroclus broke among the Trojans. A set of zealous bones, covered with flesh, finished with bronze, dipped in blood, and the whole being inspired by ferocity. Kill them, my sweet Patroclus. Kill them! As many as you can, for coming behind you, in the dusk, you felt, what was it? Felt the darkness part, and then, Apollo! Who had been patient with you, struck. His hand came out of the east, and in his wrist lay eternity. And every atom of his mythic weight was poised between his fist and bent left leg. And it hit the small of your back, Patroclus. Your eyes leaned out. Achilles' helmet rang far and away beneath the cannon bones of enemy horses. And Achilles' breastplate, 5 copper plies mastered with even bronze, split like a pod. And you were footless, staggering, amazed, between the clumps of dying yourself, dazed by the brilliance in your eyes and the noise like waterfalls heard far away. So you staggered, blind eyes open, dabbling your astounded fingers in the vomit on your chest. And all the Trojans lay and stared at you, propped themselves up and stared at you, feeling themselves as blessed as you felt cursed. All of them just lay and stared, except a boy called Euphorbus. He took his chance and cast straight. The javelin went through both calves, stitching your knees together, and you fell not noticing the pain, and tried to crawl towards the fleet, and even now, snatching Euphorbus' ankle, and got it? No, not a boy's ankle that you got, but Hector's, standing above you, his bronze mask smiling down into your face, putting his spear through, and saying, "Why tears, Patroclus? Did you hope to melt Troy down and make our women carry home the ingots for you?" I can just imagine it. You and your marvelous Achilles sitting. Him with his upright finger wagging, saying, "Don't show your face in here again, Patroclus, unless it's red with Hector's blood." You fool. You weak, impudent, silly little fool. And Patroclus, shaking his voice out of his body, says, "Big mouth, remember it took three of you to kill me. A god, a boy, and last of all, a hero. I can hear death calling my name, and yet somehow it sounds like Hector. And when I close my eyes, I see Achilles' face with death's voice coming out of it." Saying these things, Patroclus died. And as his soul went through the sand like water, Hector drew out his spear and said, "Perhaps